Good morning all. So today is the 26th class for electromagnetic theory. So we are about to complete the second module. So in the last class, we saw what is absolute potential, what is the potential difference, and when do we say work is done. All these things we have seen in the last class, the previous class. So today we will see some more things related to this potential difference, absolute potential and all. Like what is an equipotential surface, what is a potential gradient, and then we also do some numerical problems which are asked in previous year university exams. So first of all, we will see what is an equipotential surface. So equipotential surface, when you say, we will consider an electric field environment, we'll consider initially, and you'll consider a charge delta Q, and we need to move the charge delta Q from P1 to P2. So likewise, every time we do, we consider a small length dl and we try to find out the electric field there, and in that electric field environment, how much work is done to move the charge delta Q from one point to another in the small length dl, we'll find out, and then we will integrate. That's what we do. So one thing we can say that the electric field will always try to push the charge away from here . So we need to apply an external force, right? A charged particle, when it is kept in electric field, and the electric field will try to always move the charge. So we need to apply an external force. So that means we need to do some external work, right? So that external work, delta W is equal to negative of delta Q. So we have already seen why this negative and all comes. Delta Q from P1 to P2 integral E dot dl. So you know E dot dl is the potential difference V. So Q into V, that's the work done. All these things we have already seen. So I'm just bringing you back to the subject. So what we do, delta limit delta Q tending to zero, delta W by delta Q is equal to minus of integral P1 to P2 integral E dot dl, which is equal to V21, that is potential difference between point space 1 and 2. So that is V21, which is the potential difference, that is work done per unit charge. We can also say it as work done per unit charge. So that is V21, or that is a integral P1, negative of integral P1 to P2 E dot dl. So what we can see, the work done is independent of the path chosen. So we call it the conservative C. So we can see that work done is independent of the path chosen. So the work done is independent of the path chosen. So we call it conservative field. So all these things we have seen in the previous session. So since we are starting the class after a very considerable gap, I am just revising all these things, bringing you back to the subject. So then what is V21? V21, as you know, is the potential difference between two points in which we are moving the electric charge. So we can write V21 is equal to V2 minus V1, and if V1 is equal to zero, V2 will be equal to absolute potential. So clearly I have derived all these things, like what happens when it comes to infinity, all these things we have seen. And so if we have a charge Q here, and this is the point P1, and this is the point P2, and then this will be the position vectors, then will be the length AR, and this is the position vector R2, and this is the length DL. then we can write V21 is equal to V21 is equal to minus integral R1 to R2 E dot DL, that is equal to minus integral R1 to R2 Q by 4 pi epsilon R square into unit vector AR into DL. All these things is electric field into DL. So we wrote the equation for electric field. Then that is equal to minus of integral R1 to R2 Q by 4 pi epsilon R square into dr, that is equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon into 1 by R2 minus 1 by R1, that is equal to V2 minus V1. So from here we can write what is V2 and what is V1. That's why we are writing all these things. So V2 will be equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon R2 and V1 is equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon R1. And if R1 becomes tending to infinity, means because we say work done is the potential difference is the work done to move a unit positive charge from infinity to that point. So all these things we have seen in the last class. So just I am revising you the last class portion. And now, because this basics is required to understand what is an equipotential surface. Okay. So now coming in detail to what an equipotential surface is, this can come for your exam, university examination point of view, and more than the examination point of view, you should have the concept. So we'll consider a charge Q and we will have at a distance. So we'll consider some three distances from charge Q. So this will be R, and so that is the radius. And then at a distance R, we have a potential V1, and then here the potential will be V2 and potential will be V3. So we know that the equation is V is equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon R, the equation for potential. So we can see that the potential around the circumference will be same, because at a distance R, and okay, we will call this R1 and let this be R2 and then let this distance be R3. So we can see that at R1, R2 and R3, the potential will be same. So the understanding is like, no different potential lines will intersect with each other. No different potential lines will intersect with each other. Then point number two. So actually, till now we have been studying the two-dimensional picture. So what is actually an equipotential surface? If the points having same value of potential are joined in a two-dimensional field, we will get a curve of constant potential, and such a curve is called the equipotential line. So the points having same value of potential are joined in a two-dimensional field, we will get a curve of constant potential. That curve is the equipotential line. That is the equipotential line. Okay. So in three dimensions, the maps of the points having same value of potential is an equipotential surface. Upon two-dimensional angle, it will be an equipotential line. And in 3D, the map of points having same potential is an equipotential surface. Is an equipotential surface. Okay, so these are the two conditions, and then there are some properties of equipotential surface that you should understand. So, properties of equipotential surface. So, university examination point of view, you can get a question based on this. So, it's better you understand these things. So, equipotential surfaces are continuous surfaces. The shape of the surface depends upon the distribution of charge. So, first point is they are continuous surfaces, comma, the shape of which, the shape of which depends upon this distribution of charges. Second point, equipotential surfaces of different potential do not intersect as the electrostatic potential has a single valued function. So we have already, I have already written that in the during the introduction, so I'm not writing it again. Then work done in moving a charge from one point to another along an equipotential surface is zero. So the work done, because potential is same, there is no need of work being done. And also we can say that the tangential component of electric field intensity on the surface is zero. That is, the direction of electric field intensity can only be normal to an equipotential surface. The third point is direction of electric field can only be normal to an equipotential surface. So that is the third point. And then we can say that the work done in moving a charge from any point on an equipotential surface to any point on another equipotential surface is independent of the shape of the bar. So the second point is about the work done in moving a charge from one point to another on the same equipotential surface. Then work done in moving a charge from one equipotential surface to another equipotential surface is independent of the path taken. So because we already know work done is independent of the path taken. So same concept only we are applying here. Nothing more. So I hope all these things, because these are the basic theoretical sections that you should understand regarding equipotential surface. So these things come in your electrostatic portions. And then one more topic that you should know is about potential gradient, because potential gradient is separately mentioned in your syllabus. So potential gradient, what does that mean? So potential gradient is the relation between electric field intensity and electric potential in differential form. So you know gradient and all. So relation between electric field intensity and electric potential in differential form. That is what we call as electric field intensity. So, for example,
to define the gradient of V, let us consider the equipotential surface. So we consider two surfaces. I'll change the color. So we consider two surfaces. So this is the surface S1 and this is the surface S2. So in here, the S1 is at a potential of V and S2 is at a potential of V plus delta V. And this is the path. So, you know, if at all we have to do some work, that will be independent of this path, but still we need to show the path. So here, and this is delta N. And we are moving from S2 to S1. And we have, and delta N is the gap. And we have the field lines between equipotential surfaces. So there will be field lines between equipotential surfaces. So what we need to do is we need to find the gradient of V. Gradient of V by considering S1 and S2. So we know that delta V, that is the potential difference, is minus integral E dot dl, that is equal to minus of, so we take the average value into delta N. So delta N is a gap, right? Here dl is delta N only. Then we can say that delta V by delta N is equal to minus EAV. So we call it equation number one. Then limit delta N tending to zero, delta V by delta N is equal to dV by dN. So we are bringing in the differential component, that is equal to minus E. Is equation number two. So what we consider is the positive direction of dV by dN is towards increasing potential. So increasing potential means from S1 to S2. That is V is one potential, and V plus delta V means increasing potential. Towards increasing potential. So what is potential gradient? Potential gradient is equal to dV by dN into AN, that is equal to minus AN is equal to minus E, that is unit vector we neglect. That is, so this we know. How we will find out? Del V, gradient of V is equal to minus E. So we know that del V is equal to dou V by dou X into AX plus dou V by dou Y into AY plus dou V by dou Z into AZ is equal to minus E. So all these concepts. So this del V, that is equal to grad V. We are not doing two times, okay? Del V, which is equal to grad V, that is equal to minus E. That is what finally we get. So, this is for Cartesian coordinate, how we find out. Similarly, you have the equation for cylindrical and spherical also. You just need to find out those things also. So that is how we find out the potential gradient. Now we will do one numerical problem from this topic, which was asked in previous year university. We have given V is equal to 10 sine theta cos phi divided by R square. We need to find the field intensity at 2.5 meter, comma, minus 60 degree, comma, 45 degree. So what will be the solution? So we already know the equation E equal to minus del V equal to minus of, so this is in r theta phi format. So r theta phi means this is spherical coordinate. So spherical coordinate del V equation. So now you understand why the basics are very important. Plus a theta by r into, so I am just rearranging and writing the equation. Okay, so don't get confused, the same equation only. So a phi divided by r sine theta into tau by tau theta. So that is equal to, so this is del, and okay, so into V also it will come. Okay, into V. So next step I'll write. So 10 into 2 sine theta into cos phi divided by r cube. So I'm taking the derivative into ar minus cos theta cos phi divided by r cube into a theta plus sine theta divided by r cube into a phi. So this was direct, really direct question, but still you need to know some basic concept and all. So we know that the value of r is given, theta is given, so phi is given. So these values you can substitute here. You can use your calculator, and then you get 0.7838 AR minus 0.226 A theta plus 0.45 A phi. So what is the, what will be the unit? Unit is very important, volt per meter. So I hope that, so whatever we have seen today, it's clear for you. So what initially we have brushed up whatever things we have studied in the previous classes. So what is the work done? What happens when we keep a charge and move it in an electric field? What is conservative field? Then we saw what is equipotential surface, then properties of equipotential surface. And then we understand what is potential gradient. So we need to bring in the differential concept. So it is the relation between electric field intensity and electric potential, E is equal to minus del V. So we derived that, and then we understood that it is del V, that is gradient of V. So you know the all the three equations. So only Cartesian I have written here, so you must know. Then we did one simple problem to make your concept understanding really strong. Okay, so today I'm winding up. Thank you.